Madam Speaker, how town councils perform matter. How our public housing estates are managed impacts public health, public safety, and the quality of life for millions of Singaporeans, and the value of their flats. Town councils need competent, honest people and proper systems to serve their residents well. Good intentions and bland assurances alone are not sufficient. Elected MPs need to supervise the work of their town councils and their managing agents. While they enjoy wide autonomy, they also have huge responsibility and they are accountable to their residents. They have statutory duties, but they are also subject to national laws. This is the first time in the history of town councils that the Auditor General has undertaken a special audit on a town council to look into concerns about its financial circumstances under Section 4, Subsection 4 of the Audit Act. The AGO report has set out clearly its approach and its findings. It's a sad commentary on the state of affairs at the AHBETC. In summary, the Auditor General's investigation has uncovered major lapses. It added that, I quote, "there can be no assurance that AHBETC's accounts are accurate and reliable, or that public funds are properly spent, accounted for, and managed," unquote. In other words, AHBETC's financial and accounting processes and systems are unreliable and their accounts inaccurate. This is a cause for serious concern. These are all public monies. As stewards of public funds, all town councils must keep proper accounts and records and maintain adequate control over their assets. Who has paid? Who has not? How is the money spent? Is it properly used? Is anybody doing anything wrong? Is the town council solvent, being able to pay its bills on time? Does the town council have enough reserves in its sinking fund to replace major infrastructure when it is needed? For example, can the town council afford to replace the lifts when it is time to do so? These and many other questions directly affect the interests and the safety of the residents. They are not trivial technical issues raised merely to satisfy the accountants or the auditors or to meet financial regulations. There is always a temptation when a town council is financially strapped to postpone saving and say it will make up the shortfall later, or worse, to put his hand into the cookie jar, to draw from the savings to satisfy immediate needs. Just spend, use the savings first. Sounds appealing. But the town council will then be simply running down its reserves and mortgaging the future of its residents away. And that is why the town council's act and financial rules enforce saving to pay for replacements and major repairs which have to be carried out in future. The Auditor General also found that, I quote, "there were control weaknesses and lack of documentary evidence that payments to the related parties were independently verified so as to ensure that work has been satisfactorily performed and payments were fully justified and correctly computed," unquote. The report cites, I quote, "instances where the Secretary and General Manager issued payment claims as owner of FMSI and director of FMSS respectively, and subsequently the same general manager certified these payment claims and approved the payment vouchers in her capacity as an officer of AHBEDC, unquote. In other words, it's very convenient. The husband issued the payment voucher, the wife approved the payment, and the wife also co-signed the check, and it's all in the family. The Auditor General concluded that, I quote, taken in totality, AHBEDC did not adequately manage the conflicts of interest involved in related party transactions, unquote. This means that AHBEDC may not have obtained the best value for the monies paid to these related parties. Or worse, there could be opportunities of wrongdoing or unethical practices which AHBEDC may not be able to detect or prevent. Now, town councils award millions of dollars of contracts each year. Residents and taxpayers need to know that their monies are properly spent and they are getting best value for money. When these contracts are awarded to parties related to the town council, the town council needs to be upfront with its residents as well as with taxpayers at large, so that there is transparency and proper scrutiny. In total, AHBEDC has close to $27 million worth of contracts with its two related parties, FMSS and FMSI. Of these, close to $6 million was given without tender. The Town Council appointed a related party, FMSS, as its managing agent. The owners of FMSS are Mr. Danny Low, who became the Town Council's secretary, and Ms. Hao Wing Fan, Mr. Low's wife, who became the Town Council's general manager. There were occasions where Ms. Hao certified work done, approved the payment voucher, and approved the check from the Town Council to her own company. The Auditor General has found insufficient disclosure of the related party transactions in AHBEDC's financial statements and lack of evidence of safeguards to manage the conflicts of interest of related parties arising from the ownership interests of its key officers. Why? Why did AHBEDC not disclose these related party transactions and take steps to prevent the risk of abuse when the companies it gave contracts to were owned by its key officers? FMSS was paid abnormally high fees. It was paid 20% more than the previous managing agent that ran Aljunied, 50% more than a comparable town council, and more than any other town council. Why? Unfortunately, throughout this saga, we have found the MPs running the AHB town council to be evasive, unresponsive, and misleading. In response to legitimate queries from auditors, my MND office officials, and their own residents and the media, they stonewalled, deflected the queries, made false or dishonest claims, raised irrelevant excuses, and sought to confuse the public with a flurry of red herrings. First, their lack of transparency. They failed to disclose things on time. They failed to submit reports they should be submitting. Every time we reminded them, again and again, they came up with yet another excuse. AHBEDC's financial year 11 and financial year 12 financial statements were late, and its financial year 2013 statements are still outstanding. AHBEDC's SNCC arrears reports have been outstanding for nearly 2 years. Financial incompetence aside, failure to carry out critical cyclical maintenance work is an even graver safety concern. For instance, even AHBEDC's financial year 2013 cyclical maintenance works report which informs MND of any delays in replacing major infrastructure, was late for more than 6 months, incomplete and inaccurate. This is serious, as it potentially impacts on public health and safety. For instance, we expect lifts to be replaced after 28 years. If the Town Council prolongs the replacement of a lift beyond the recommended operating life, we require them to disclose it and declare that it remains in serviceable condition and has been duly certified by qualified personnel. But AHBETC does not seem to be exercised over such reporting. Each time MND officers update me on their Town Council submissions, it reads, AHBETC still outstanding. Why this lack of transparency? Why are reports from AHBETC always outstanding? Throughout this sad saga, what are the MPs of AHBETC doing? I don't expect them to take over the job of their managing agent, but I do expect them to exercise close supervision, and when problems arise or issues are highlighted, step up, take responsibility, look into them quickly, and address them squarely. This is the accountability that we expected of all elected MPs, or for that matter, any company director or any member of the governing board of a charity. Instead, what we have consistently gotten from the MPs of AHBETC is sidestepping and avoiding responsibility. First, no response. Then, in due course. And then, followed by a series of excuses, blaming everybody else for their failure to perform. Finally, last month, AHBETC declared that they had, I quote, embarked on a roadmap to enhance its aggregated arrears reporting module sometime in November 2014, unquote. This is their response to a problem in June 2013, 17 months earlier. Simply astounding. MND expects AHBETC to follow up and remedy the problems and weaknesses listed in the AGO report. It's already too late for AHBETC to submit their financial year 2013 financial reports on time. But MND expects them to submit an unqualified set of their financial year 13 financial statements to MND by June 30th this year. And financial year 2014 financial reports by August 31st this year. This must be tabled to Parliament, just like the financial reports from all the other town councils. MND further expects AHB Town Council to deal decisively with the gross incompetence of its managing agent. Please do something for the sake of your residents. There has been overpayment and public funds have been affected. Will the Town Council be suing the FMSS for return of money lost? Meanwhile, MND is studying what other legal recourse any aggrieved party may have. The Auditor General reported that AHBETC had no proper system to safeguard important documents and had weak accounting procedures. It did not provide key information required by its auditor and the Auditor General. Now, Madam, a key plank of Town Council's accountability towards their residents is via their financial accounts, which have to be audited annually by an independent auditor and tabled to Parliament. AHBETC's failure to provide information to its auditor and the Auditor General has completely undermined the system of accountability. AHBETC's repeated failure to do so shows a disregard for its obligation to account to its residents and also disregard for this Parliament, of which the HBDC's chairman, vice chairman, and their fellow MPs have solemnly sworn to serve in. As the accounts are unreliable, we do not know the exact state of AHBETC's financial position. Based on their published reports, AHBETC's financial position has deteriorated sharply since Aljunied Town Council was merged with Aukang Town Council in 2011. The audited financial year 10 financial state accounts at Aljunied Town Council had reported an operating surplus of $3.3 million. By financial year 12, the merged town council had incurred a $734,000 operating deficit. The deterioration of HBTC's financial position was in part due to Aljunied absorbing Aukang and its bad finances. In financial year 10, before merging with Aljunied, Aukang Town Council had an operating deficit of $92,000. It was also partly due to the abnormally large fees it paid to its managing agent, the FMSS, which was fully owned by the key officers of AHBETC. Madam Speaker, the Auditor General's findings confirm that something is seriously wrong at the AHBETC. They paint a picture of financial mismanagement, incompetence, and negligence in corporate governance. If an auditor makes such a finding on a listed company, it will immediately cause consternation among the shareholders and a call for the removal of the CEO and the board of directors. Where there are breaches of the Companies Act, both the company as well as the individuals responsible could be charged, and if found guilty, punished with fines and on jail terms for the individuals. Even for charities, if the auditor makes such a damning finding, the Commissioner of Charities will haul up the governing board and key officers for a full inquiry. They will be suspended and eventually removed from their duties. If the findings are borne out, they can also be charged and punished for any breaches of the Charities Act. Town councils are not regulated under the Companies Act or the Charities Act. As I explained in this House in May 2013, Parliament decided in 1989 to give elected members of Parliament more authority and responsibility over the HDB estates in their constituencies in order to strengthen the nexus between the residents and their elected MPs. The strategic intent was to bring home to the MPs that how they manage and run their town council will affect their electoral fortunes at the next election, and to voters that the MPs they elect will be responsible for looking after their housing estates. This would enhance accountability, push MPs to focus on what mattered to the residents, and in turn, encourage voters to scrutinize more closely the capabilities and track record of election candidates. That is why the Town Councils Act deliberately takes a light-touch approach to regulation and enforcement. However, light-touch does not mean that the MPs and the councillors running the Town Council bear no responsibility and need not be held to account if the Town Council fails to perform. By law, the MPs and the councillors are ultimately responsible for everything in the Town Council. They cannot simply delegate their responsibility away to their managing agent or any others